Well, thank you very much for these very generous introductions and laudatio. It was so good that I was thinking it was somebody else you were talking about instead of just me. It's a wonderful thing for me to be here in Leipzig, and it is also emotionally very charged because indeed to live in the Ritterstrasse just in front of the Nikolai Schule, the Nikolai Kirche, where Leibniz was also baptized. It's really wonderful for me, especially having written this intellectual biography of Leibniz, in which I really learned a lot about Leibniz's world, about the Holy Roman Empire, about this wonderful world, which is not so well known. And about a wonderful time in which Leipzig was at the very center of very important intellectual ventures. And this is still the case. I must say that people I know who told me, oh, Leipzig is really wonderful, will be extremely interesting, well, they were right. I am finding that being at the philosophy department is extremely stimulating, and it's just enough to look around to see that there are research institutes, the Academy of Sciences, the Research Academy. It's really a wonderful place to be. So thank you very much for having invited me. Today I will speak about theory and praxis in Leibniz's theological thought, and this will be an example of this interdisciplinary approach I have to Leibniz, because I think that is what Leibniz was, somebody who really worked in such a great range of different disciplines, and who can only be understood if one takes these different perspectives together. You have an handout, so I will be referring to that, especially for some of the passages I am going to read. The importance of properly theological concerns in Leibniz has long been underestimated. A striking example of this is the still ongoing Akademieausgabe of Leibniz's writings and correspondence. Now, I have the highest regard for the Akademieausgabe, wonderful enterprise. But in this respect, it's striking that out of the 8 series, there is no theological series. Even more, theology is not even mentioned in any of the titles. So we find general correspondence, mathematics, physics, technical writings, linguistics, philosophy, medicines, and no mention of theology. Despite the fact that if you go to the catalog of Leibniz manuscripts, which was prepared for the edition, the first big bunch of writings is labeled Theologie. So why is that? I think that the editorial decision to leave out of the main thematic structure of the critical edition, theology, is an example of the kind of historiography which was dominant in the period around the Great War, which linked inevitable progress to irresistible secularization. So when it came to theology, Leibniz was either a metaphysician or a political pragmatist. The metaphysician dealt with the typical issues of natural theology, so the existence of God and so the attributes of God, and that could be straightforward be reduced to metaphysics, or the political pragmatism was read just as a courtier who devoted needless attention to the small details of revealed theology just to please his patrons, or on a more sympathetic reading, to serve the political needs of his day. So this was the dominant historiography, which I think underpins this editorial decision. In the light of recent scholarship, of which also my own work on Leibniz is part, I will try to reassess the place of theology in Leibniz's philosophical system and in his thought more generally, focusing in particular on the relationship between theory and praxis. Can one really conclude that anything over and above metaphysics is adequately captured by Leibniz's political agenda? It is beyond the doubt and dispute that Leibniz's theological views were shaped by his political context. But the question to be posed here is whether this political dimension of Leibniz justifies the reductions of Leibniz's engagement with theology to mere Kirchenpolitik. As we will see, there is a remarkable pragmatic streak in Leibniz's approach, especially to Christian theology. But is this pragmatism irreducibly political, or did it rest in turn on an emphasis on praxis, which is genuinely philosophical and theological? In trying to answer briefly this question, this lecture takes as its point of departure a general conclusion which I have tried to establish in my previous work and especially in the intellectual biography of Leibniz. Namely, that Leibniz's key formulations of his overarching plan of reform were ultimately conceived for a practical aim, and that is the improvement of the human condition and the happiness of humankind. So that is what Leibniz really wanted to do. Against this backdrop, I will argue that Leibniz's robust theoretical engagement with theology was in the service of a science that he conceived as ultimately practical. For Leibniz, the ultimate aim of theology was to lead, and he says that explicitly in a number of places, was to lead to the love of God above all things, and in so doing, to salvation, which he conceived as eternal happiness. It is in the light of this practical aim, I think, that his theological pragmatism should be evaluated. When this is done, it becomes apparent that beneath Leibniz's efforts at reconciliation in the context of his Kirchenpolitik lies a deeper, fundamental, and properly theological emphasis on praxis grounded in Leibniz's epistemology. The key features of this epistemology will be briefly explored during my lecture, notably Leibniz's distinction between absolute certainty and moral certainty, his doctrine of confused or vague cognition, and his notions of probability and safety. I will conclude by saying something that is somewhat unexpected, and it was, I must say, unexpected also for me. And that is that Leibniz's theological pragmatism is in certain ways remarkably close to a family of prudential approaches to religious belief and religious epistemology that goes into the family of the sort of approach Pascal and later on William James have proposed to religious belief. At the same time, I think that the end of happiness, whether whether worldly happiness or eternal happiness should not be regarded as competing with Leibniz's theoretical endeavors, but as directly supported by them. And at the end, I will say a few things of why this is the case, that one should not take this ultimate practical aim as in competition with the theoretical inquiries. After all, the motto of the Academy of Sciences of Berlin was Theoria cum praxi, and Leibniz meant that. So let me say, first of all, just a few words regarding the practical aim of Leibniz's all-embracing program. Leibniz's own formula for pulling together the numerous threads of his extraordinary life work is the following, and you have this on your handout, so we can read it together. To practice charity, the love of God above all, is in fact to love the common good, bonum publicum, and universal harmony, or, which is the same thing, the glory of God. And again, to Duke Johann Friedrich of Hannover, all these things, that is, all the things Leibniz was doing in mathematics, in philosophy, in history, and all his programs of reform and so on, are connected and have to be directed to the same aim, which is the glory of God and the advancement of the public good by means of useful works and beautiful discoveries. In a way not uncommon to the architects of early modern science, Leibniz conceived of the advancement of science as the best way to celebrate the glory of God in his creation, because science, the advancement of all the sciences, were conceived as the best way to improve the human condition, and therefore is the best way to support human happiness. So the reference to this broadly ethical, broadly theological concerns as the framework in which Leibniz was working, I think cannot really be disputed. But let's now look more specifically at the way in which Leibniz conceived theology in a more strict sense, in the context of his philosophy and in particular of his epistemology. So first of all, theology and theory. Let me say a few words regarding Leibniz's engagement with Christian orthodoxy. The body of texts which I have first collected and then studied and tried to interpret, as it was said before, it was striking to me when I actually went to read this stuff that reducing it on the one hand purely to metaphysics, on the other hand purely to political writings, just doesn't do justice to its context. I mean, Leibniz did mean to engage with the other theologians in a very sophisticated point of Christian theology. Some of these things, they were completely coached into the very sophisticated theological scholastics of the time, and Leibniz clearly was taking position, was not writing wishy-washy texts. He has a very clear idea of where to go on one issue, on the other issues, and so on. In particular, it is striking with regard to the central doctrine of Christian theology, such as the Trinity and the Incarnation or the Eucharist, that Leibniz did not adopt a minimalist, dogmatic attitude in the service of his Irenicism and ecumenism. This is very different from Locke, for instance. If you are familiar with it, one way in which Locke, together with other authors, Grotius, for instance, tried to advance toleration was to reduce to a minimum the dogmatic content of Christianity. Leibniz doesn't do that. For him, it seems to be clear that Christian dogmatic has a genuine claim to expressing truth above human reason, while at the same time needing to be rationally defensible. In my view, Leibniz intended this rational defensibility in three main ways. First, there must be philological and historical support to the authenticity of the texts and the antiquity of the tradition. Second, it must be possible to defend any given Christian doctrine from the charge of logical contradiction. And third, it must be possible to give some kind of plausible explanation of how such doctrine could be true. This explanation, however, would not amount to a demonstration of truth, but as it were to a provisional explanatory hypothesis, which allows for competing explanatory hypotheses. This last point introduced me to the next section of my lecture and to a part which I would like to explore at some length, that is to say, theology and praxis in Leibniz. One way of approaching Leibniz's conception of the practical end of theology is via the strong analogy between theology and jurisprudence, which he maintained since his youth. Remember, Leibniz was a trained jurist. Indeed, his doctorate was in law. He wrote in the Early Test, I quote, "Theology is a certain kind of jurisprudence taken generally. It concerns, in fact, the right and laws which obtain in the Republic, or rather, the reign of God over human beings." The analogy continues with the distinction in both theology and jurisprudence of a natural part of which the principle is reason. And here we have in theology, natural theology, and in law, natural law, and a positive part of which the principle is the authority of a text. And here we have the Bible in revealed theology, and human positive law, the law of the various countries, as opposed to natural law, on the part of law. Again, Leibniz carries forward this analogy to say that natural theology as a natural law can count on the absolute certainty of demonstration, whereas a positive of revealed theology and positive human law on the other hand can rely on a certainty which is only moral. That is the certainty based on the weight of reasons, verifying facts, like the authenticity of text, the authority and trustworthiness of its author, and not on the absolute certainty of logic. So let's explore for a moment this distinction between absolute certainty and moral certainty. Leibniz distinguishes between absolute certainty and moral certainty not only in theology, but and in law, but also in philosophy. He writes regarding his first presentation of his all-embracing program of demonstrations. He writes, "This program of demonstrations should contain three sections. The first section is to demonstrate the existence of God, the immortality of the soul, and all natural theology, since in effect I have attained surprising demonstrations." This is the young Leibniz talking. The young Leibniz was particularly self-confident about demonstrating a lot of stuff. later on he became a more prudent sort of man. The second session should be about the Christian religion or revealed theology. In it, I would like to demonstrate the possibility of our mysteries of faith and solve all the difficulties raised by those who claim to show that there are absurdities and contradictions in the Trinity, the Incarnation, the Eucharist, and the Resurrection. For the proofs of the Christian religion are only moral, because it is not possible to give others in matters of fact. And here Leibniz is thinking in particular of the Incarnation. Now all the proofs that carry only a moral certitude can be overturned by stronger contrary proofs, and therefore one must also answer the objections to satisfy oneself entirely. Since a single proven impossibility in our mysteries capsizes the whole boat. So, whereas natural theology enjoys the absolute certainty given by strict demonstration of such truth as the existence of God and the attribute of God and the immortality of the soul, revealed theology cannot but rely on moral certainty. That is, crucially, on the kind of certainty which is sufficient to rationally ground action. So moral certainty does not have the absolute certainty of demonstration of mathematics, but it has enough certainty to ground our acting in a rational way. Moral certainty, as we read, can be capsized by absolute certainty. What we reasonably held to be true on the basis of moral certainty can in principle demonstrated to be false when a charge of inconsistency is proved with metaphysical certainty. However, as long as this does not happen, it is rational to act, and indeed we should act on grounds of moral certainty. Recalling the use of juridical practices to tackle issues which are theoretically uncertain, the distinction between moral certainty and absolute certainty aligns with the juridical practice of holding something as true or innocent until proved false or until proved guilty. Some 20 years later, Leibniz writes, "Theological truths and inferences are of two species. Some have a metaphysical certainty, others have a moral certainty. Philosophy has two parts, the theoretical and the practical. Theoretical philosophy is founded on true analysis, of which the mathematicians give examples, but which ought also to be applied to metaphysics and to natural theology in giving definitions and solid axioms. But practical philosophy is founded on the two topics or dialectics, that is to say, on the art of estimating the degrees of proofs, which is not yet found amongst authors who are logicians, but of which the jurists have given examples that are not to be despised and that can serve as a beginning for forming a science of proofs suitable for verifying facts and for giving the meaning of texts." At this point, so we have seen the analogy with jurisprudence, Leibniz actually advising us to look at jurisprudence in order to know how to deal rationally with a theoretical uncertain situation when there is no demonstration, how to deal with that. One may still wonder, however, what practice has to do with holding as true highly theoretical doctrines of revealed theology, such as the Trinitarian nature of God or the real presence of the body of God, of Christ in the Eucharist. So to answer this question of what has to do with praxis, holding as true these theoretical doctrines, we have to look at Leibniz's notion of confused or vague cognition and at its links with the notion of probability and safety. Confused cognition, and you have a few tests there on your handout, page 3. In an early test, completely built on the analogy between theology and jurisprudence, the Commentationcula de Judice Controversiarum, Leibniz claimed that in order to believe in the Christian mysteries, I quote, "It is necessary that the intellect should not fall nakedly over the words, like a parrot." And here Leibniz is targeting Spinoza and what Spinoza wrote in the Theological Political System treatise. "But that some sense should appear before it, albeit a general and confused one, and almost disjunctive, as the country fellow, or rather common man, as of nearly all theoretical things." So this faith will be disjunctive, inclining nevertheless to one side. And this is in fact, if you pay attention, what many Christians do in practice. After noting that this is a kind of blind thinking on which not only common people rely, but also, Leibniz says philosophers, when philosophers speak of things such as matter, form, cause. So Leibniz says, yes, we use these terms, but then ask a philosopher to define really what matter is, and then press that, and then you will see that there is a lot of vague thinking behind these terms. So Leibniz concluded, "To anyone who maintains that a distinct cognition of the meaning of the mysteries of faith is necessary to salvation, it will be demonstrated by me that hardly the thousandth of Christians ever had it. And as a consequence, it suffices for salvation to hold on to the formula expressed in the Holy Scripture with a confused cognition of the meaning by the intellect, and with a kind of disjunctive assent or belief." I think these passages are representative of the overall approach of Leibniz toward religious doctrines of revealed theology, which fall outside the sphere of demonstrability. Remember that for Leibniz, the existence of God and the immortality of the soul is another matter. This can be demonstrated. But when we go to things like the Trinity, the Incarnation, the Eucharist, here is a sphere clearly outside demonstrability, outside absolute certainty. And this is where is strong pragmatism comes really to the fore. Leibniz thinks that provided there is no proven contradiction, and provided we have some kind of vague, confused understanding of what this mystery means, we are prima facie rationally justified, or we are prima facie our belief in these mysteries is prima facie rationally justifiable, at least. In other words, although on the one hand one cannot believe in the words of the Last Supper, "This is my body," unless one has some confused grasp of what these words might mean, On the other hand, it does not matter whether the sense in which these words are taken correspond to the true meaning, as long as belief in this or that specific sense of the words has no practical consequences which could endanger salvation. So as it was pointed out to me in a discussion, it does have some practical consequence whether you believe the real presence of just a symbolic understanding of the Eucharist, but what we are dealing here with is practical consequences which would have a bearing on salvation. Leibniz concludes, it is not always necessary for faith to know what sense of the words is true as long as we understand it. So there must be some degree of understanding of what the words might mean. No, we do positively reject it, so there must not be a proven contradiction, but rather leave it in doubt, even though we might be inclined toward some other sense. Indeed, it suffices that we believe in the first place that whatever is contained in the meanings is true, and these are first and foremost in the mysteries in which the practice does not change, whatever the meaning may finally be. So Leibniz devoted a huge amount of energy, for instance, in proposing his own metaphysical model for the Eucharist. And that was important to him because in the context of unification between the Roman Catholics and the Protestants, the Eucharist was one of the stumbling blocks, or between the Lutherans and the Calvinists, and so on. So it was important to him to make proposals. However, as far as I can see, Leibniz continued to regard his own theological theories as acceptable explanatory hypotheses, which did no more but also no less than contributing to the necessary task of providing a plausible sense to Christian doctrines without which we would not be able to believe them. Because we cannot believe just in words, we have to latch on some sense, which must be to some degree a plausible explanation, although Leibniz does not claim to be able to demonstrate that or to have shown that it is the true explanation. In other words, these theories could not claim to be true, but only to be possible. I do not mean to underplay the fundamental importance for Leibniz of such a claim to possibility, since any proven impossibility would be equivalent to prove the falsity of the doctrine in question. For present purposes, however, I merely wish to draw attention to this approach, grounded in his epistemological notions of absolute and moral certainty and confusor and vague cognition, as the underpinning of Leibniz's strikingly pragmatic attitude when it comes to doctrines of revealed theology, in which absolute certainty is not available. So let's look a bit more at this very pragmatic streak. And it goes even more in that direction when we look at the notions of probability and safety. A conflict between a sacred text and reason arises, Leibniz explains, when the meaning of the text of the Bible is unclear and reason cannot reach certainty. So what Leibniz means is the following, I think. There are plenty of passages in the Bible which are difficult to interpret, which are not clear. If reason can reach absolute certainty, like in the case in which some anthropomorphic imperfection is attributed to God, then reason said, no, that must be interpreted metaphorically, because there cannot, reason tells us that there cannot be imperfection in God, so that's settled. But there are plenty of other cases in which you cannot reach this absolute certainty. So what you do when you have some probable meaning of the test, which is improbable, but not impossible, according to reason. Because if it is impossible, we are home and dry. When it is improbable, according to reason, should we go with the more literal meaning, or should we go with a more rational meaning? In particular, he tackles this for the issue of the resurrection of bodies, asking whether priority should be given to scripture affirming the resurrection of bodies, or to reason, pointing to the intrinsic improbability of such a thing happening. Leibniz is clear. If there are historical and philological reasons strong enough to support the claim to authenticity of the text and the antiquity of the tradition, that is to say, in other words, if the three main Christian confessions agree on it and say, yes, that was all the time believed by the church, priority should be given to the text, provided that the doctrine does not include any contradiction, of course. The credit given to the words of the text, despite their improbability according to reason, rests on the peculiar characteristics of the one who has promised. Leibniz proposes the example of two men: Titius, rich and just, Caius, poor and a born liar, who promise a large sum of money. Although it is intrinsically improbable that anyone will give a large sum of money to somebody else, Leibniz says, Titius' words, which are under oath, and we know this Titius, we know that he never lies, we know that he has also the money. So although it is intrinsically improbable that somebody would give such a big, larger amount of money to somebody else, because of the specific situation and what we know about these Titius, we should come to the conclusion that we should take the promise. On the contrary, in the case of Caius, who is a born liar and does not have the money and will never have the money, the same sort of promise should not be taken. Leibniz continues, and you have this quote on your handout. Let us transfer this to God. God is obviously this Titius. Indeed, he is also very rich, or rather very powerful, and very wise as well, so that his words outweigh all the words sworn by others. This God promises that our bodies will be resurrected. Considering this in itself, without the promise, it is indeed not impossible, as all admit, but yet it is improbable ever to be, that the parts of a thing scattered in thousands and thousands of pieces of places should be gathered together again. Hence, the Socinian, that is the heretical movement which was at the time strongly opposing the resurrection of bodies, conclude that it is improbable even if taken with the promise, and the words of the promise must be interpreted otherwise, metaphorically, figuratively. On the contrary, the Catholic, and by Catholic Leibniz means not the Roman Catholic, but the Lutheran, the Calvinist, and the Roman Catholic, the three main Christian confessions, the Catholic concludes that taken with the words of the promise and acting the circumstances of the person speaking, it is probable and to be kept in practice that God wants his words both to be understood in the proper sense and those are put into execution. And as he can, he will do. I would like to draw your attention to the penultimate part of this paragraph. That is to the statement that it is probable and to be kept in practice. It is clear that we are here in the sphere of the verum putare, holding something as true, as opposed to something that we know to be true. We are in the sphere of something that Christians believe on the basis of motives of credibility, but that cannot be claimed to be known with certainty. The absolute certainty, certainly not. To borrow an expression by Leibniz from a much later text, the evidentia, the evidence, is not in rebus, in the things, but in personis. The evidence is not in the thing, but in the person. Interesting enough, this is very close to what Locke says when it comes to these issues, that when we are dealing with this field, which is above reason, in which we cannot claim theoretical certainty one way or the other, what we should take into account is not just the nature of the thing itself, but what we know about the person promising it. In this case, what we know, for instance, about the Bible or about the Quran, what is the antiquity of the tradition, what is the sort of philological support we can give to the text. That is to say, the grounds of probability that what has been promised will actually happen are not intrinsic, but extrinsic. They are to be found in the authority, trustworthiness, and so on of the person who has promised, and not in the nature of the things which has been promised. All these considered, Leibniz says, in practice, we should stick to what is safer. So, notwithstanding Leibniz's robust theoretical engagement with highly theoretical doctrine of Christianity, this engagement appears to have been significantly driven by prudential consideration. So Leibniz says, in theoretically uncertain matters in which salvation might be at stake, we should hold on to the safest course of action when in doubt. This pragmatism is apparent also in Leibniz's later text. One should not consider only what is intrinsically most probable, but also what is safest. I quote, and you have this quotation on your handout. Indeed, I confess that we should regularly follow appearances and hold them as truth. But since often many things appear contrary to one another, the rule necessarily is left aside, and one must try to discover which greater likelihood then is to be followed. In this, we should not consider so much which opinion is more probable, but also which is safer. And here Leibniz is not speaking in particular about mysteries, he's speaking in general what are our grounds for reasonable action in a situation of theoretical uncertainty. When neither the test nor reason can adjudicate matters with sufficient certainty, one should do what is safer. In the case of the resurrection of bodies, hold on to the long ecclesiastical tradition which affirms it. And Leibniz writes, certainly it is most unsafe to weather and play the skeptic in affairs of salvation. where every danger is to be held great for the very magnitude of the thing which we put in peril. And this reminds of the kind of reasoning Pascal puts forward. I come to my conclusion and try to bring together these various strands, theory and practice. In theoretically uncertain matter with matters with a bearing on salvation and therefore on eternal happiness, the criterion to follow was for Leibniz a prudential one. In such matters devoid of absolute as opposed to moral certainty, the most reasonable course of action is to do what is safer, even when such action relies on what is intrinsically improbable from a strictly rational point of view. In a way, this is analogous to advising drivers to fasten the seatbelts, even if an accident is very improbable. According to Leibniz, when eternal life can be at stake, the safest thing is to hold on, that is, act on, endorse, accept, subscribe to doctrines which can claim a long ecclesiastical tradition in the main Christian denominations. Leibniz was a traditionalist. It really, tradition to him meant a lot. At least as long as they can be cleared from the charge of absurdity. This is not to dispute that holding on to traditional doctrines of revealed theology had for Leibniz also a straightforward political importance, because Leibniz was living in a time in which Christianity was just underwoven in an inextricable way with the political balance of power in the empire. So for him, obviously, to uphold as rationally justifiable Christianity had also a political meaning. However, I hope to have said enough to show that this political aspect of Leibniz's theological pragmatism was not the only aspect. It seems to me that his theological pragmatism cannot be simply reduced to Kirchenpolitik. Seems to me, as I said, that it had a genuinely theological aspect to it, similar to the Pascalian way to approach these issues. In any case, ultimately, salvation did not depend for Leibniz on believing a set of objectively true doctrines. As he thought the doctrines of Christianity were. Ultimately, salvation does not depend on believing objectively true doctrines, but on a practical attitude. The love of God above all things. Leibniz says anyone can be saved in any religion as long as he or she loves God above all things, even if this person is objectively in error. Because Leibniz did not think that opening up, as it were, salvation to all religions, as long as the people engaging in that religion loved God above all things, he did not think that that had as a consequence the relativity of the truth. The core of Leibniz's theology as a theology of love is ultimately concerned with what to do more than with what to know. This is in line, I think, with the practical inspiration of Leibniz's intellectual program as a whole. Leibniz was a man who, more than anything else, wanted to do certain things to improve the human condition. Even the most abstract inquiries in metaphysics, mathematics, physics, and so on, ultimately were for him at usum vitae, in the service of life. Therefore, I think we should not be surprised that also in his theology, ultimately theology is in the service of life. This, in this case, eternal life. So we should not be surprised that also his theology is ultimately driven by considerations about salvation and how to reach eternal happiness. At the same time, and I am coming here to my last point, this practical end should not be seen as in a competition with his theoretical enterprises. Why is that? Not only because Leibniz, as it happens, he was better at the theory than at the practice, when he was trying to do something, really make machine work and so on, he was not so wonderfully able, but in the practice, there is where he really got his best. I think it's not only for that, but is because Leibniz thought that the best way to improve the human condition is actually to engage in the advancement of the sciences. So the best mean to improve practically, and the best mean to promote human happiness is through scientific research. In the end, the same approach is reflected in Leibniz's theoretical engagement with theology and his commitment to a robust Christian dogmatic, which is rationally defensible. Knowing God and believing true doctrines, is the safest road to salvation, but it is not the only way. As I said, Leibniz thought that one can be saved also believing false doctrines, religious doctrines, as long as one loves God above all things. Now, Leibniz's view of theology as ultimately practical was far from unprecedented or of dubious orthodox pedigree. It is true that it sounds much more like Paul's hymns to charity than Luther's emphasis on faith. But after all, in the Christian tradition, charity is traditionally seen as the preeminent amongst the theological virtues. Moreover, amongst predecessors, Leibniz could count theologians of the stature of Bonaventure, who regarded the principal end of theology as our becoming good and being moved to love God. In conclusion, Leibniz's theological pragmatism, apparent especially in his approach to revealed theology, should not be regarded as merely secular and political, but as grounded in a practical orientation, which has as its final aim charity, which was genuinely and fundamentally philosophical and theological. Thank you.